If you're anything like me, you do your best to prevent fungi from growing, like on your groceries or in your shower. But a lot of people also like shiitakes and portobellos. And yes, those are fungal crops, so sometimes the goal is to encourage fungus growth. Despite how good we are at growing those fungi, there are still some of them that refuse to be produced on large scales. That's why morels are such a forager's dream. You can't really plan out a morel plot in your home garden. They grow where they want to grow. But after decades of research, we've made a few breakthroughs in cultivating the most stubborn fungi. Here are four mushrooms we've finally figured out how to farm. First up, we have the mushroom forager's white whale, the morel. Specifically, black morels can be found across North America and in a few other parts of the world. But for a long time, they had to be foraged. We couldn't grow them ourselves. The primary roadblock was that morels have super particular growing conditions. They seem to take their cues from specific weather patterns, like wet conditions following a period of nutrient deprivation, aka spring rains after the winter. And that's why foragers also know when to go looking for mushrooms. What kind of weather forecasts mushrooms, if you will? While it's tricky to create those conditions artificially, that hasn't stopped folks from trying. And researchers are making progress. A breakthrough came in 1986 when researchers patented a process for mimicking the weather patterns of the morel's natural life cycle. First, they fatten up the fungal network, called mycelium, to get a solid starting point. Then they recreate winter conditions by depriving it of nutrients for a bit before spring kicks in and they flood it with water. These external cues coax the mycelium to bloom and produce mushrooms, which spread spores and perpetuate the life cycle. So after years of mystery, scientists finally got a couple morels to grow in a greenhouse. The next decades were spent perfecting this method to produce morels on an industrial scale. And in China, black morels have been cultivated en masse since 2012. But maybe that's more by luck than skill? It's still quite common for crops to fail, indicating there's plenty left to learn. Most recently, in 2022, a pair of Danish farmers announced they can use super precise climate control to produce black morels indoors year-round. And as you can imagine, they're still pretty tight-lipped about their morel whispering skills. But one thing they've admitted is that growing grass alongside the morels seems to help them fruit. Though maybe the best way to grow morels is with complete nonchalance, like when you're trying to get a cat to let you pet it, because morels commonly pop up unplanned in suburban mulch. They most often pop up on the west coast of North America, but I found some ones in Boston, so maybe that load of mulch came from Washington State or something. So you might not have to venture that far to get a glimpse of the rare and picky morel. The next mushroom on our list isn't as picky about weather in the same way as morels, but it is picky about corn. Huitlacoche could be seen as a brutal sign of a ruined crop, or as a rare delicacy. This fungus forms when young ears of corn are parasitized by a specific strain of smut. No, not that kind of smut. We're talking about fungal diseases, far less sexy. This kind of smut turns kernels into bulbous tumors that are sometimes blue or black, so not your typical sweet corn colors. Then they eventually burst open to spread dusty black spores, like a really gross confetti cannon. Basically, the spores infiltrate the silk of a young ear, spread through the plant tissue, and secrete proteins that suppress the plant's immune system so it can hijack the corn's defense mechanisms. Talk about hardcore. Now I'm gonna give it to you straight. This is bad for corn. Because it's so detrimental to the plant, researchers had to pick a side, and for many years, they were pro-corn, not pro-fungus. To prevent the smut from ruining crops, farmers turned to fungus-resistant strains of corn and relied heavily on fungicides. Under this antifungal regime, huitlacoche was rare, which seems like a win, except that it's a delicacy in Mexican cuisine and an important ingredient in indigenous medicine. There are 55 different diseases that it's used to treat. So scientists had to figure out how to undo what they'd done and find the ideal growing conditions. With a little bit of research, we now know that corn strains with higher sugar content are the best hosts for huitlacoche. Now, indigenous farmers have long understood that young ears can be inoculated with huitlacoche spores via the corn silk. But studies on the inoculation process have only recently been published in peer-reviewed journals. Specifically, researchers have figured out what age the corn should be when it's exposed to the fungus in order to get maximum huitlacoche yield. And if the corn is kept unpollinated, they can get up to 150% more huitlacoche from it. With better understanding of the fungus's life cycle, we know how to more successfully inoculate corn and improve fungal crop yields. There have even been several successful trials for greenhouse-cultivated huitlacoche. So if you hadn't heard of it before, you might be seeing a lot more of it in the future. But you probably have heard of this next mushroom. It's another legendary find for foragers and Stardew Valley completionists. In the wild, chanterelles only grow near the root systems of mature trees. They need trees for their sugars. And in exchange, the fungi move water and minerals from the soil toward the tree's roots. But they aren't usually too picky about the exact trees they grow near, which helped researchers understand the various weather and soil conditions that typically produce fungal fleshes. The thing is, if you only grow next to trees, you're tough to grow in a greenhouse because, you know, trees are big. Despite that hang-up, in the 1990s, they were cultivated in greenhouses for the first time, alongside seedlings of their symbiotic trees. It took 16 months of patience between inoculating the soil and the first greenhouse chanterelle popping up. But even then, the research team couldn't tell what made it bloom. Part of the challenge is that chanterelles seem to have a special relationship with certain bacteria, meaning you have to feed the mycelium, the bacteria, and the host tree. But we're still making progress toward viable greenhouse production. Most recently, scientists have unearthed the connection between temperature fluctuations and a subsequent flush of chanterelles. They, like me, prefer temperatures between 19 and 27 degrees Celsius. They've also learned chanterelles do best in slightly acidic soil with low nitrogen content. While these greenhouse studies are promising, chanterelles still grow best in forests, alongside 10 to 40-year-old trees. When they pop up naturally in a young timber stand, they can spread to establish themselves throughout the forest. But to speed things along, another strategy could be to inoculate tree seedlings in a greenhouse, then transplant them to the forest and hope the mycelium network takes root. For forests that already produce chanterelles, some groups are advocating for waiting longer periods between timber cutting, which would allow larger crops of chanterelles year over year. There are also ongoing genetic studies, which will hopefully reveal which chanterelle species are best suited for cultivation in new growth forests and greenhouses, respectively. And since chanterelles aren't the only mushrooms that need trees, all of this research could help us grow porcini and matsutakes too. But arguably the most famous tree-dependent fungus in the culinary world gets its own section in this video. In general, mushrooms are the fruiting body of a fungus, the part capable of spreading spores. So if you see a mushroom above ground, then you know that fungus spread its spores up here, where wind can carry them to a new destination. But unlike many other fungi, truffles fruiting bodies stay buried beneath the soil. The truffles are the fruiting body, the mushroom part. They rely on animals to eat the mushroom and spread the spores that way. Because they grow entirely underground where we can't see them, it's hard to study their growth. And we can't cultivate them in a lab, which means we can't study their growth. You get it. It's a vicious cycle. But we do know a few things about them. We know they only like a couple types of host trees. Black truffles, the most famous variety, only grow near oak and hazelnut trees. But even if you plant those trees and do your best to inoculate the soil, it still takes up to 10 years to get your first truffle crop, if you manage to get a crop at all. So truffle farming was slow going, until a study in 2010 found that black truffles have specific mating types. See, to successfully produce truffles, you need both maternal and paternal genes, mixing it up in the same patch of soil. Any given patch of mycelium can produce both maternal and paternal genes, but they can't fertilize themselves the way some other fungi can. Instead, they need another truffle patch to contribute the opposite type of spores. If the first truffle patch offers up maternal genes, the second truffle patch needs to put in paternal genes, and vice versa, or else no new generation of truffles from that lot. Insights like this help truffle farmers increase their chances of bearing fruit. And that's before we start branching out to different kinds of truffles. US-based farmers are also experimenting with native truffle species, rather than only pursuing the most famous European varieties. In the Pacific Northwest alone, there are about 350 indigenous species of truffle. Maybe one of those could be the next big culinary hit. And native species could increase a truffle farm's biodiversity. Diversifying truffle varieties and growing locations is a good idea anyway. Simulations of climate change trends predict that there will soon be little to no truffle foraging grounds left in Europe. Heat, drought, fire, and pests could realistically decimate up to 100% of European truffle production within the next 70 years. But with this new truffle farming knowledge, other countries could take on the mantle and become the world's next big truffle producer. Today, there are about 200 truffle farms across the US. Apparently, the secret to truffle farming was in our own backyard all along. As a mushroom enthusiast myself, I'm eager to try some of these farmed fancy fungi. Maybe all I need to do is buy a bag or two of mulch. We'll be right back.